Hey folks, this is Best in the Slot. Welcome to, I want to say, part 12 of 747 of our Jurassic World Evolution 2 analysis, speculation, theories, all that good stuff. Today we're going to focus on the brand new genetic system being added to Jurassic World Evolution 2. This is a really interesting one. We'll talk about why in just a second, but this came from the Game Informer article that I covered a couple of days ago. There's a lot of super exciting stuff in that video that got mentioned, tons of it. So this maybe flew under the radar a little bit, but I think it's worth talking about. I think it's got some really cool implications for the game itself. So let's get started. So first of all, I'm just going to read you what was said in the article. When eggs are synthesized, you can tweak the DNA to enhance social behaviors, make them more resilient to disease, less aggressive to rangers, and more. Rather than incubating one egg at a time, you can now generate a clutch of eggs. As part of this editing phase, you are increasing or decreasing the chance of any of those traits manifesting, adds Newbold. Once you make that decision, you choose which ones you want to bring to maturity and release them all in one go as a group. So there's really three things to pick out here, two main things. The little one is that, you know, the dinosaurs are going to get released in a group, which is really interesting. It makes them feel like more of a little family. You know, they all came from the same clutch of eggs. That's a nice little touch. But there's two main things I want to focus on. The first is, of course, enhancing behaviors, stuff like that. We kind of theorized about this for the first Jurassic World Evolution, and it didn't really turn out to be true. What would happen in EVO 1 is you would change some genetics and it would change the stats of your dinosaur. That did include social needs. That did make it in. But generally speaking, it was your attack and your lifespan and defense and stuff like that, mainly battle focused. And it would have been really cool if genetics could influence the actual dinosaur behavior and how they interact with the world around them. That seems to be something we're now going to get, you know, less aggression, resilient to disease, and of course, those social behaviors. The other interesting part is just all of this in the bottom bit, the idea of creating a clutch of eggs using the same genetic systems, genetic soup basically, and then you have several eggs. We're going to talk more about that system in a little bit. So let's focus first of all on the first bit. Now you can tell we're into the science because there's some DNA in the background taken from Google Images. Serious science stuff. There's our boy Mr. DNA. And really what we're talking about here is transgenics. I mean, this is kind of what we were talking about in the first game as well. And transgenics, transgenesis is basically the transference of genes of one species into another. And that was what the first game was like. You were taking genes from various animals, snakes, sharks, bats. I think there was a shark, maybe there wasn't a shark, snakes, bats, I think there was an ibex or something at some point, and a bunch of frogs, and just a bunch of different animals, and then it would affect the stats of your dinosaur. Now what would be really cool is if the animals chosen for this transgenics bit was more directly related to the behavior imprinted on the dinosaur. We'll talk about that again in a second, so let's just move on from Mr. DNA there. It is interesting, worth noting whilst we're here though, transgenics is not really a new technology. It kind of took off in the 1990s, but there are still many problems with it. In particular, mutations are a very real possibility. Obviously, we get better and better at that kind of thing, but you know, it'd be interesting to see if the more genetic modification meddling that you do, the higher chance of rogue mutations making it into your, we're going to call it genetic soup. Pretty sure that's the technical term. Anyways, we have an egg. So what would those genetic options even be in the first place? Well, we've heard of a few already. So the first one would be social behaviors. We can assume that's maybe like it was in Jurassic World Evolution 1, where you can control things like pack size or population needs. Aggression modification, it did specifically mention the rangers, as in the dinosaurs would be less likely to attack the ranger vehicles. It could also apply to other dinosaurs as well. And maybe this would be a, what's a friendly animal? And maybe this is genes from a bumblebee, because bumblebees are cute and very friendly, sort of. Disease resilience, next on the list. So these are the three that were mentioned in the article. Don't really have much to say on that one. Just makes it hardier, just makes it more resistant to disease. Seems like a decent thing to have. It really depends how complicated disease is going to be in Evolution 2. In Evolution 1, a disease could spread pretty quickly, but once you've got all your diseases researched, it was generally speaking going to be okay. Given Evolution 2 has an increased focus on naturalism, on wild dinosaurs, on dinosaur welfare and care, there's a chance disease is going to have more of an impact this time around. So we'll have to see how much value that has. That might be an interesting video, actually. I do have a bunch of my own ideas, though. The article did mention there was more available. So, for example, territory and species mixing and general values. There is a new territory system in the game. That's another thing I'll talk about in more detail in the future. But basically, dinosaurs have we're assuming a radius around them, and they establish a territory, and they'll be able to get along with some dinosaurs within that territory, and they'll clash with others within that territory. If two dinosaurs with separate territories don't get on and those territories clash, I think they'll compete for the territory. I've said the word territory too many times, it doesn't sound like a real word anymore, but I think that's what will happen, basically. So maybe by giving our dinosaurs a specific cocktail of genetic code, we can make them more receptive to other species, more willing to let other species live within the territories that they establish. Likewise, another new thing that was mentioned was food, as in certain dinosaurs are going to prefer certain types of natural foliage, Triceratops eating from a type of ground fiber. We don't really know how that system's going to work in its entirety, but it is going to be a thing, and dinosaurs will need certain types of food. But what if you could add in genetics into your soup, into your mixology cocktail? It's a soup and a cocktail, it sounds disgusting. What if you could throw in some genetics into your soup tail, which then, you know, lets your Triceratops eat food usually reserved for hadrosaurs, for example, and that way you could have them living in the same habitat and have to maintain or add less types of plant life. It's also an option. Injury resistance does what it says on the tin, really, doesn't it? We know injuries are going to be a bigger part of evolution. Dinosaurs will be mildly injured and able to be cured via the mobile vet unit vehicle, but the ones that have suffered greater damage will have to be brought back to the park, will have to be brought back to the new paleo vet building where Zia, that's how you pronounce it right, is going to be doing her thing. But the more seriously injured dinosaurs, the ones who pick a fight with a Struthiomimus, will have to be brought back to the paleo vet building for better care, basically. Injury resistance would make a lot of sense as genetic as well. Just take some genes from a starfish or something. If your Ankylosaurus gets its head bitten off by an Indominus Rex, just grow a new one. It's fine. Nothing to worry about. Final on my list is crazy stuff. Ooh, that's what crazy stuff sounds like. And I just mean, the first thing that popped into my head was the bioluminescence from Jurassic World Camp Cretaceous. It's a bit of a stretch, but crazy stuff, just more visual things or things that are a little bit out there. I'm thinking like the camo gene for the Indominus Rex in Evolution 1. Stuff kind of in that kind of vein, you know? Things that are less about care and about well-built exhibits and more about stupid things, because we need a little stupidity and a little bit of personality. Now that's all well and good. Those are some likely behaviours. It's an interesting system. I'm really intrigued to see how it's going to come together. But I've got some idea on how this could work based on what he said. He said, if we go back very quickly, this is actually not going to be as quick as I would like. You can now generate a clutch of eggs. And during that edit phase, you are increasing or decreasing the chance of any of those traits manifesting. Once you make that decision, you choose which ones to bring to maturity and release them all as a group. So I did a little step by step. It really does feel like I'm making presentations in high school when I do this kind of thing. I did a little step by step of how I think this system could come together. So step one, choose the genetics for your eggs. You've got your soup tail. Let's say it's, for example's sake, it's got a point system, right? So each soup has 100 points. You could add in reduced aggression for 50 points and funny hat for 50 points. And maybe other genes are rarer and harder to include. You know, there could be more obscure genes that are rarer to activate, albino ones and stuff like that. Again, it seems unlikely, but the crazier stuff could be less likely to happen even if you activate it. And maybe you fill in all these different slots and let's say there's 10 different genes and you pick the ones you want to put into your eggs. You then choose how many eggs you want to produce in the first place. I think this number will be, I'm not sure, but I feel like it might be restricted depending on the dinosaur type. He mentioned 3 pteranodons escaping at the same time, 2 T-Rexes. Could you though fit, say, 2 brachiosauruses in the same hatchery? They'd have to come out one after the other, you'd assume. Little curious how this will work, but I feel like each dinosaur may have a max clutch number. Anyway, so you've got your soup, you've thrown all your genes into your soup, and then you're saying, I want to make 5 eggs. And I'm assuming each additional egg carries a cost. I don't think this stage of the process will be free. Step 3, make egg. Top tip for life in general. So you've chosen your genetics, you've picked, say, 5 eggs, and depending on how many genes you pick and what those genes are, definitely the former, if not the latter, then you're going to get 5 eggs with random combinations, or not random, I don't know, but seemingly random combinations of the previous genes. One of them might only have one gene, the reduced aggression or the funny hat, whereas another one might have both. And this is kind of where the risk-reward system comes into play here, and this is actually part of why I really like this system. Instead of just having your dinosaur fail or succeed and then cranking out another one, what you're basically doing is balancing several things. You can add more genetics in for better dinosaurs, but not only is that probably going to make it more expensive, but it reduces the chance of each individual gene popping up. And of course, if you have, say, 2 genes in your selection, then the chance of a dinosaur having both the funny hat and the reduced aggression is probably pretty good. But let's say you increase the coolness as well, then having all 3, it's probably a lower chance than just having the 2. So making the ultimate dinosaur is going to require big clutches of eggs and multiple attempts and stuff like that. That's worth keeping in mind. This is my best guess. This is my estimation of how the system will work, but this makes a lot of sense to me. So anyway, you produce all your eggs. Some of them have the genes you want, some of them don't. Maybe you can sell the other ones off or something like that for, say, half price. And then what you do at the end, of course, is choose good egg. So step 4 is basically choosing good egg, and I've helpfully labelled the good egg in case you were curious. So you choose the good egg and you release it, or you release 2 of them, maybe 2 of them have the funny hat and the reduced aggression, and you scrap the others. Anyway, that's kind of my theory. That's how I think the whole system will roughly come together. And I've got to say, I do really like it. I think it's a really cool idea. I think, especially if there's quite a lot of genetics, if some of them are rarer than others, let's say there's... okay. Let's say they're super cool, this is a hat, and that's... there you go. There's a super cool gene that looks like this, okay? This is the super... it's not increased coolness, it's the super cool gene, okay? And let's say the super cool gene only has a 10% chance of taking. You know, you stick it in your cocktail, in your soup tail, but if you made 10 eggs, on average, only one of them would actually have the super cool gene. If you've then all got all these other genetics as well, competing for the same spots and fighting with it, sure, sometimes you could end up with super cool gene and funny hat, like this lad right here, but adding the funny hat reduces the chance even further of getting the super cool gene, you know what I mean? So basically, to get the genes you specifically want, it's probably good to leave them on their own and not throw in lots of genetics. The interview with Newbold definitely suggests that you're raising and lowering the chance of certain genetics to make it into your eggs, basically. But on the other hand, if you want all the genetics, then you're taking that chance as well. It's got a really nice balance of risk, reward, and different systems you have to think about. It's much less hands-off than the previous genetic system, and it makes a lot of sense. This kind of transgenics and genetic tampering and all this is very integral to Jurassic World evolution, Jurassic World, and indeed Jurassic Park. One of the major points, if not the major point, of the original Jurassic Park was to warn about the dangers of genetic tampering, of gene engineering, because this was the early 1990s, and in the previous decade it had really just started to take off as a thing, in the sort of 70s, 80s in particular, and then it got a lot bigger during the 90s. So Crichton was worried about that. That was Crichton's whole thing. It was all about the dangers of advancements in science without due diligence, basically. Right, from me and from Danny DeVito, thank you so much for joining me. If you enjoyed this speculation, please do throw me a like down below. I'm feeling pretty confident that the system we get is going to be something like this, although I did chuck out a couple more out there ideas. I would love, though, to hear what you folks think, so let me know about that in the comment section down below, and subscribe if you're new to the channel for lots more videos just like this one with stupid jokes and eggs. Okay. Thanks for joining me. Cheers, much love as always. Bye-bye.